Are your self-hosted services secure from the outside world? Hi everybody and welcome back to another IBRACORP video. The topic of today's video is securing self-hosted services. We'll talk about reverse proxies, VPNs, firewalls, what the differences are, how we can utilize them to our best advantage, and some different approaches to both security and remote access at the same time, and finding that real sweet spot that benefits your setup and how you like to operate. So, without further ado, let's get stuck into it. Many different people set up Unraid, Docker containers, or home servers, but we often forget the security basics. We get so caught up in wanting to get remote access to all of our cool apps that we've set up, whether it's a requesting app like Overseerr, whether it's any other sort of service that you're running from home or your cloud server. We rush to get things like reverse proxy set up and then look at the authentication and security side of it afterwards, once we've got it already exposed to the web. So by the end of this video, I hope you will know how to use reverse proxies, VPNs, and firewalls together to keep your services safe. So what are some things that make our setups vulnerable to the web? One of the biggest things is exposed ports. Then it's things like default configs, brute force bots, and other sorts of misconfigurations that we haven't quite gone back and cleaned up. Some real risks to think about are things like ransomware, data breaches, or even just getting your Plex server hijacked. Now, I've brought up my Unify dashboard here just to give you guys a bit of a look. Mind you, your mileage might vary when it comes to what sort of threats you're seeing over a time span. But even with all my different setups, this is over a 1 month period, the type of things that we're looking at. Any really high security things, not much of a concern to us. That's a really good sign. We still get some suspicious and then some low. And then we get our firewall doing its thing and blocking certain activity as well. Now my Unify UDM Pro has a built-in firewall with something called IDS and IPS, or intrusion detection systems and intrusion prevention systems. Now, as the two names suggest, one is purely just detect threats. It won't do anything about it. It will detect them and let you know. Then you've got the IPS side of things, when enabled, will actually do the prevention of those threats coming through. Now, even with all of that set up, you can still see just how much activity we get coming through. Various parts of the world, there'll be different types of activity happening. The most triggered policies on my firewall are reputation lists, which most of you will experience something similar. They're just automated lists, basically, that get, you know, IPs and devices, things added to them once they're kind of publicly aware of being a risk. So everybody gets to benefit from those lists. Scanning activity, so it's picking up that some sort of reconnaissance is going on. And then we've got our actual firewall blocking particular attacks as well. So why am I showing you this? Well, the main point is that at all hours of the night and the day, whether you're home or at work, you're always being attacked. And I don't mean the word attack in someone literally always going in and knocking on your firewall door, but there's something going on all the time. And most of the time, it's all automated bots. What they're doing is they're scouring the web, scanning IPs constantly, and eventually finding where the holes are, reporting them back, and then that could trigger an actual attack on you or someone you know. What we want to do is reduce that surface area for those attacks to take place. And the biggest thing that any pen tester will tell you is having ports exposed is going to be one of the biggest. Because if you're looking at a firewall, let's just refer to it as a wall, and you're starting to take bricks out of that wall to let things through, you're leaving an opening there for other things to come through as well. So what we really want to do these days is try to avoid opening those holes entirely, in my opinion. The next best thing you can do is, if you can't completely block that hole, find a way to add extra layers of security there. The first thing we're going to talk about is VPN options that you might want to consider. I will note that this video is not specific to Unraid. We're generally talking about security and all the other tools that we've listed, so you can follow along even if we're not using Unraid. I'm just showing the Unraid dashboard here because that's what I've got open. Now, a VPN is basically a secure encrypted tunnel. The idea behind it is that only you or trusted users can access things behind the VPN or through the VPN. And they're great for things like admin panels, you know, your Unraid GUI, your Proxmox, your Home Assistant. Having them behind a VPN is safer than just having them exposed out to the web. Some of the options you have in that space are things like WireGuard, which is built into Unraid, OpenVPN, and Tailscale. There are plenty of other options as well. That's not an exhaustive list, mind you, but these are some of the most common ones that you're going to see bounced around on the web. As you go down a self-hosting rabbit hole, you'll find even a ton more. So let's have a quick look at our setup here in terms of what we're doing with Tailscale. If we go to plugins and we look at Tailscale, you'll see there are various options under Tailscale once you have it set up. We will do a setup video separately, just talking about the methodology here. But in the configuration, you have things such as accept routes, accept DNS, SSH ability, the ability to run as an exit node, whether you want it to use another exit node, and whether you want to allow LAN access. So what does that mean? Well, on our phone or mobile device or even another computer that's connected to Tailscale, when we connect and authenticate to our VPN, being Tailscale in this case, we can then type in the actual local address of that other device that's on the network or on the same Tailscale network. So what it's saying here is allow LAN access while using exit node is yes, and whether we want to run as an exit node as well. Exit node is a separate thing. So that means that if, let's say I live in Germany and I have a server set up here in Australia. And the best example of this is when I'm traveling. If I'm in another country, for some reason that country doesn't allow me to do regular things, I can actually then come through my connection to here in Australia using my server as an exit node. So the connectivity is happening from my server here at home rather than wherever I am. The alternative is if we didn't want LAN access enabled, so we didn't want to type in the 192.168 address just for example's sake, we are also given a Tailscale IP address instead for each device that we connect to the Tailscale network that we're using. Now, let's say you don't want to use Tailscale. You also have the option of using something like WireGuard, which thankfully for us is built directly into Unraid for us to use. Again, we will go through the setup in another video, but this applies the same principles where it's giving us an endpoint we can use without having to go directly through our firewalls. So, long story short, VPNs allow us to access networks or devices without opening them up to the web. But what if we do want to open up something to the web? Well, that's where a reverse proxy comes in. I have an Nginx proxy manager set up here ready to go. What's a reverse proxy? A reverse proxy acts as a middleman between the internet and your service. And the benefits that it has are hiding internal IPs, centralized certificate management, so if you have things like SSL or you want them generated, and it's going to give you the ability to use domains much easier than typing in public IP addresses. For example, nextcloud.mydomain.com. So if we imagine a cloud up here being the internet and somebody types in request.plex.com or whatever is your domain, and we've configured that domain in our DNS, wherever you host your DNS, to point to your IP address back home. When they type that in, it will go through and hit your reverse proxy. Your reverse proxy is then configured, and we can open that up here. So our reverse proxy knows that if this domain name was to resolve, pass that domain name to the following IP and port. It will then send that name over to that application that's running there that we've configured and allow that web access to take place. Now, there are various different types of reverse proxies you can use, but the fundamentals are the same. In our case, we still like using Nginx Proxy Manager. You have things like Traefik, which we've done a video on as well, Pangolin, you have Caddy, and a whole bunch of others. But finally, we get down to firewalls. Firewalls control inbound and outbound traffic, all right? They are your line of defense when it comes to protecting your environment. Usually, what you want to do is have everything blocked by default and then only allow what's needed. That's a typical configuration anyway. And when we talk about port forwarding, that's when we're allowing those holes to open up. We allow something to work, but we also open up a vulnerability. It also adds a layer where we can also configure things to block phoning home from particular devices, networks, anything else, especially those IoT devices that might be trying to call back somewhere where you're not familiar. Now, if you wanted a hybrid approach where you wanted web access to things, but you didn't want to have to open up ports, then something like a Cloudflare Tunnel is what we use. There are also alternatives to that if you choose to use them. You can use it through something like Pangolin as well. But the idea with using a Cloudflare tunnel is, rather than a domain name pointing to an IP address, it points to a masked tunnel. That tunnel configuration in the backend knows where to send the traffic without revealing to people who snoop on those DNS records where that origin exists, or in other words, where your server lives. So in terms of the flow we're talking about, user types in domain name resolves to the tunnel. The tunnel points back here to our server, which communicates to our reverse proxy, and then everything else carries on the same. So from the user's end, there's no difference, and from the opposite end, there's no difference. However, we just add that extra layer involved so that we don't have to reveal the origin IP address at any point. What's the trade-off of that option? Technically, you're trusting Cloudflare to mask that information for you, and so you're handing that responsibility to a third party. It is worth mentioning for those who aren't comfortable with that. But on the plus side, we don't have to open up any ports anymore, so those ports are no longer open for those websites or even our reverse proxy. Port 80 and 443 are the most commonly attacked ports because they are HTTP and HTTPS protocols. So not having to expose the reverse proxy is a huge win for our security. So some easy wins you can apply if you want to involve more security when it comes to actually not using a tunnel option. Start looking at things like DNS protection, DDoS protection. We can use things like fail to ban or CrowdSec with our proxy so they can work hand in hand and they'll actually become an extra bouncer involved to help monitor the traffic coming in for anything malicious. And the number one thing you can do is enable two-factor authentication on your admin dashboard. It's really important. Please don't expose anything that doesn't need to be. So what's a common scenario here at IBRACORP on how I like to do things when I want to access stuff remotely? Pretty simple. I actually rarely expose anything to the web anymore. That is the easiest thing for me to manage. I find it works a lot easier than trying to involve other authentication methods over the top and managing that upkeep. So for me, basically nothing is exposed to the web. Even though I have a reverse proxy running, nothing is exposed to the web besides Overseerr. So that's something I would apply an authentication layer on top of and use something like Pangolin, Authelia, Authentic, any of those options to protect it even further. But everything else doesn't get exposed. Oh, and besides Plex, of course. Everything else doesn't get exposed, which means, yes, I can't directly access it from the web. However, all I really need to do is log into my Tailscale instance, and then I can just simply type in the local address as if I was here at home working on those apps. That means all those things don't have to get exposed, and I get to continue working on them as if I was at home anyway. That's especially handy with things like SSH. If you're working through a terminal, you don't want to be connecting over the internet or have those SSH options open to the internet at all. So I can have them open locally, connect in to Tailscale, and then I open up my terminal and just continue working as normal. All my shortcuts are in there, so I don't have to remember typing in any IPs. So what are some of the takeaways? Don't expose your services directly to the internet unless you really have to. Just avoid it. It's the easiest option, guys. Use a reverse proxy for clean access, a VPN for admin-only apps, and a firewall to enforce least privilege. And just start small. Close any unused ports that you've got open right now. Log into your router or your firewall, see what you've got exposed, and start cutting back on things that are just obviously not required anymore. It's often that we even remove a container, remove an app, and then forget to go back and clean up our networking site. So what's your setup? Do you rely on a VPN, a proxy, both? Drop a comment below. Let's compare notes. And if you want more security first self-hosting guides, hit subscribe so you don't miss what's coming. Thanks guys, and we'll see you in the next IBRACORP video.